Hey folks, this is going to be our second screencast on the big four molecules, and this time we're going to talk about proteins and nucleic acids. So when we talked about carbohydrates and lipids, we mostly used carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen, but today we're going to add phosphorus and sulfur into the mix as we create our two other kinds of biomolecules. So let's begin with nucleic acids. So the point of nucleic acids is to transfer genetic information from parent to offspring, or from one generation to the next. And the two that you're most familiar with are probably DNA and RNA. Now usually we find nucleic acids in the nucleus of the cell, which is also sometimes called the control center of the cell, but sometimes we find them out in the cytoplasm as well. DNA has a characteristic double helix shape, which looks a lot like a twisted ladder, and it's made up of several different components. So it's made up of sugars, phosphates, and that's where we're going to see that phosphorus that we talked about in one of our first slides, and then it's also made up of four different varieties of nitrogenous bases that make up sort of the rungs of the ladder. So now we're going to take a look at those. So if we were to zoom in on this boxed area of the cartoon of DNA, this is what it would look like at the molecular level. So you have several different components. So in this teal color right here, so we have the phosphate group. That's made up of a phosphorus bound to four oxygen molecules. And then we have a pentagonal sugar. And this right here is called ribose. You can see that it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points. And then we also have this part right here. And this is going to be the most important part of the DNA. This is called the nitrogen base, and there are four different varieties, and they pair together in a very specific way. DNA and RNA are shaped pretty differently from one another, so they both have the same components in terms of their phosphate sugar backbone, but they have different numbers of strands. So DNA has two strands that are complementary to one another, so they pair together, and then RNA has only one strand. But both of them are made up of the same components. In DNA, adenine always pairs with thymine, and cytosine always pairs with guanine, so A and T and C and G. And the order and combination of base pairs determines what we call the genetic makeup of an organism. A chunk of the DNA double helix is often called a gene, and the gene is the base pair combination that results in a specific trait. So if you have one combination of base pairs, you might end up with red hair. But if you had a different combination of base pairs, you might end up with blonde hair. The way that this works is DNA is essentially a set of instructions for how to build certain proteins. So depending on the base pairs that you have, you might have the instructions for building black-haired proteins, or you might have the combination of base pairs that codes for building brown hair proteins. The DNA base pairs that you have are a hybrid of your mother and father's DNA, and this is why you oftentimes look a lot like your parents. The human body does make mistakes, though, and so sometimes you wind up with what's called a mutation in your DNA, so you don't have an exact copy of what your mother or father has. Now let's move on to proteins. So proteins have a huge variety of different shapes, sizes, and jobs in the body. And there are a lot of different examples, but here are just a few. So they have proteins that are called enzymes. We have structure proteins that help us to build the solid parts of our body. We have storage proteins. And then we also have hormonal proteins that work on signaling. But the point here is that every single one of these different types of proteins is going to be an enormous molecule, and it's going to have a very specific shape and size. Without that specific shape and size, it could never do its job. Now let's talk protein structure. So no matter what kind of protein you're creating, you're going to make it out of a combination of 20 different amino acids. So you might have a lot of one kind, just a few of another, but there are 20 different varieties of amino acid building blocks. So let's imagine that each one of these different colored squares is a different amino acid. Now we only have 6 different varieties here, but remember that there are actually 20 different kinds of amino acids. I'm now going to connect each of these amino acids to the ones on either side of it. Amino acids are bound together by a bond with an oxygen in the middle of the two of them. So we have two bonds with an oxygen in the center that connects each amino acid. This type of connection is called dehydration synthesis, and every connection that you make will produce one molecule of water. So here is my water, and it's going to involve two hydrogens and an oxygen, which together make up a molecule of water. So this connection process, if I were to connect all six of these amino acids, would produce a series of water molecules. So after I connected all of these, I would have produced a total of six molecules of water. And as a result, I've produced this long chain of amino acids. Now this chain right here has a name. It's called a polypeptide. And the reason that it's called a polypeptide is because each of these bonds that are in between the amino acids are actually called peptide bonds. This chain, however, is not a protein yet. It's still only called a polypeptide. The polypeptide chain has to be folded and packaged in the Golgi apparatus until it achieves a perfect shape. Until it achieves its perfect shape, it won't be able to perform its job as a protein. So let's just do a quick recap of this. So the building blocks of proteins are called amino acids. And there's 20 different varieties, and we have to string them together into a long chain using peptide bonds. We call this a polypeptide. But this isn't a protein yet. We have to fold it into exactly the right shape for it to actually be a protein, no matter what the protein's job is ultimately going to be. So we fold it in the Golgi apparatus, and then finally we have a protein.